Thanks, guys, for giving up your afternoon. It's wonderful to be back. It's a good 35 years later, and it looks the same, eh? I just don't want to remember some of the things we've done here. I'm so glad for you guys to study at a place like this. It's a wonderful place. It's in the heartland of real life called Joburg. Raising a family, you know, and looking after a family and trying to make a career work out was the two basic things I've done with my life. And then I only had one hobby, one simple hobby, and that's to try and understand human beings a bit better. That's how boring my life was for the best part of 30 years as an adult. Seeing what human beings do with their lives, how they make decisions, why some of them are happy, why some of them are successful, and why not. That was a fascinating journey for me. And today, and over the last 10 years after leaving real life, I'm trying to just guide young people, 30-year-olds, through the quest of understanding life a bit better. Because what I've found in my career is that your big mistakes and your big breakthroughs start at 30. Not younger. You know, you can study anything, you know. What studying helps you with is to structure your intelligence. Whether you're an artist, you know, or an accountant. It helps you to distinguish between big and small and high and low and so on. It's a very important thing. But then somewhere towards the end of your 20s, you have to make up your mind about what your life will be like. And many people don't. They still wait for someone to instruct them on what their life will be like. Because for 28 odd years, people guide us. They help us through 28 years. But then one day they leave you alone. But they don't tell you. So I've seen a lot of wonderful things happen to people after that point in their lives, but I've seen many people, very talented oaks who got the A's in a building like this, who got lost. And then 15 odd years later, you're actually shocked when you see them again. Because they got all the grades, but something happened in the middle. And how I figured it out in my life as a wealth manager as well, you know, sitting typically with older people, some 20 years older than you because they made their money already, I paged through their lives, literally thousands of families, you know, as people you advised, and listened to their stories, because you hear a whole story in what people tell you about their lives. And what I figured out is a simple picture, because we're talking about South Africa. I just want you guys to understand where you fit into this whole thing called a nation. I think the first important thing is to remember that what we try to do are two things in our lives. For 24 hours a day, you try to do two things. You try to make more of yourself. In other words, you optimize your talents. So in this little picture, you know, you really try to leverage off your base. That's the one thing you do, trying to be successful. But the other part of you is the blue little oak traveling with you. And that's being happy. Now, strangely enough, for 28 odd years, they teach you about the green oak. Big time. Especially you guys, talented people. From this age, these days 3 years of age, they start teaching you math and all types of other things. To one day, and then they sort of keep quiet. But what they imply is, then you will be happy. It's actually not true. Now that I found out after sitting in front of hundreds of people who made it in the green space. They made their money and they banked their 100 million bucks. And they say, I sell my business, now I'm wealthy. And then they sit back and you look deep into their eyes and you see emptiness. And then the penny dropped for me as a 30-someone, you know, in my life. Suddenly realizing that all these people who made the cut, the thing they taught us for 25 odd years, that if you make that, you make it. It's only 50% of the story. There's a blue person traveling with you, in you. Can't take an exam. Can't get a qualification. And that's maybe the dilemma, because we're used to that formula. They never teach you one day about that part of your life. I don't know if you were luckier than I was. But they don't put you down for one day on a chair and tell you, now I'm going to teach you about the other 50% of your life, being content, being fine with yourself, living a life of fulfillment, whether you're an accountant or an artist, because that's not going to give it to you. That's just something I leave with you tonight before we talk about South Africa. It's luckily there's no age barrier to this. Happiness is forever available if you want it. But what people do is, you know, this dotted line is your environment. So that's party three in your life. You need to make the cut in terms of success, which is wonderful. It's great to be successful. You have to pass the other test of happiness, consistent happiness. The third one is wherever you are. Wherever you are. Whether you live here or New York. Now, what I found in South Africa, especially over the last 20 years, many people lacking on the inside on this picture. They look for the solution in South Africa. But they actually miss something else. Because when you ask them, why are you pessimistic? They waffle. Ah, it's the president. You know, and then I always ask them, you know, if they're friendly enough, have you met the president? Have you spoken about this to him? How bad he is at doing his job? Or do you guess with a lazy journalist about this? Who has to fill a page tomorrow morning after two beers? And then you pick the old subject. It's so bad out there. So guys, the one message I want to leave with you tonight, I hope you dare to be different. And not just become another echo of some lazy opinion out there because something else is missing. The few things I want to show you tonight, I hope it convinces you that if you don't make it here, I promise you won't make it in London. And you won't make it in New York. It's not the environment. It's very functional here. We have our issues. They have their issues. I promise you they have their issues. Talked to a guy in America a week ago, you know, and he said, oh, this year I've been at home 6 weeks without leave. And I asked him, why? He said, weather. I couldn't get out of the house. In America, wonderful first world country, snowed in. Snowed in for 6 weeks, having to run his business from his house, seeing customers not pitching. Now imagine the president says tomorrow, you know, businesses must close for 6 weeks. I mean, it will be chaotic out there. Well, in America, the snow is closing it for you. And the moment the snow is gone, the hurricane will visit you. And then it will be a fell fire, but the serious one. So I'm just telling you, you know, perspective is an amazing thing. So my first point to you tonight is, you have to make three picks in your life. The first one is to live a happy life. I promise you, President Zuma cannot help you with living a happy life. Closer to home, your wife cannot help you to be happy. However much the Dominee told you long, long ago that your wife will make you happy. Your third kid won't make you happy. However loud the Lamiki is, you know, people believe that you can have kids for happiness, you can marry into happiness, you can change jobs for happiness. That blue oak is coming from a different place, not from a building. The green person, success. It's a totally different science, and I think it's very important to be successful, but that's a journey on its own. And then your third one is managing your context. Is to make sure that when you study in this place, you know, that you take everything into account applying to this place. Because this is your context at this point. So being happy, being successful, and being wise. Those are the three things you need to take with you through your life. And I just think, you know, look where South Africa fits in there. Many people see it as much bigger. South Africa is a small part of your environment. It's not in you. It's not making you as a success story. It's a little bit of context. And please never make it more. When you read a newspaper, please don't destroy your own happiness because you pull that little map into your life because of what the Bill is saying this morning. You owe yourself something better than that. Life is too short for that. Many people do it, guys. Very smart people. And eventually, they're contextually depressed. You ask them why. I listened to a guy on the TV the other night, you know, a singer, and they asked him, what makes you angry? And he thought a bit, and he said, South Africa. Now, I mean, he's one of the most successful oaks, that's why he's on TV. And she asked him, what about South Africa? And he thought, you know, because he really had to think hard now. Because he's just repeating someone else's sentence. And he said, taxis. And I thought to myself, my boy, if that's your biggest issue in life, you're blessed. Eh? You're really blessed because you have three breads, you know, white breads under each arm. And you complain about something you have to think up on this moment. So guys, just a word of caution, South Africa cannot make you happy. If you continue seeking happiness somewhere out there, don't do it, stop it. Fix it in here. It's the best place to start. And for you as youngsters as well here today, I hope you take that message with you. Your happiness is a quest only you can conquer. It's not a national thing out there. I worked with a few expats over the last 10 years, you know, and 8 out of 10 went for the wrong reasons. They took themselves with. They took themselves with. 2 went for the right reasons, you know, new opportunities, maybe one day they'll come back and say, oh, good. But it was tiring to work with those people because they still look for the problem on the outside. But they sit in London now. Now it's the damn weather, not the damn taxi. You know, they're with themselves still. And they still, the penny doesn't drop. It's now the cabs, it's not the taxis. Everything is relative in life. Do you realize that Cape Town is the most violent city in South Africa? Now, I mean, many people in Joburg want to immigrate to Cape Town, eh? Because it's so lacquer. But the world is rating Cape Town as one of the best cities on earth. Everything is relative in life. South Africa is relative to what? You see, everything, all choices in your life will be relative. It's a very important example. I mean, when you look at Ivory Coast, their maths count is number 22 in the world. Very good at maths education. But now when you ask people in Joburg, do you want to move your business to Abidjan? Because you complain every day about our maths. So there's a better option for you. Go to maths. I don't think you really want to set up your business at this point there. Maybe a bit later, but I'm not too sure now. Everything is relative in life. The whole and the sum of the parts, different story altogether. Don't get hooked on detail. That's only one part of the puzzle. People do. They are so paranoid about that number. But they won't move their business there. Now that's the most famous one these days, you know, Eskom. Now just look at the stats, you know, and you know that sentence very well. Record outages over the last year and so on. Blah, blah, blah. Only thing I'm showing you there is applicable to the United States. So the United States have the biggest level of, highest level of outages in recent memory now. And so the UK has. I chatted with the director a week ago, you know, he came from a board meeting in London. He said he overheard a conversation about generators. And he thought they're skinnering about South Africa. And he went to them and he asked them, you know, what's this about generators? He said, no, well, we have to buy generators, huh? We have so many outages in the UK now. Guys, the only difference is they're not hysterical about it. The press is not hysterical. That's the only difference. And therefore, they're not hysterical. It's context you have to manage. Same reason, the United States. I mean, the party is coming for the US. Because the seizure in their government now over the last couple of years, not infrastructure spending there, watch it. The new president in America some 7-8 years from now, he will have to get his ducks in a row. There was no spending on infrastructure. So guys, I don't think there's a place called perfection on earth. Please never look for it. There's really not a place like that. You will have to make do with what we have in life. And your mind is a bugger as well. It will tell you stories. And if I ask you, are these lines parallel or do they slope? Well, you can measure. They actually parallel these oaks, eh? Can you see what your mind is doing to you? Now, what other lie is your mind telling you about things? If it's doing that so quickly to you. So beware, guys, you know, what you look for in life, you normally find. And I see many of the older, my clan generation, you know, they actually have made up their minds about the answer, and therefore they find it. They will find it. Please be open-minded and just don't make up your mind every day about things, you know, you have to double check. What I want to quickly do with you is just run you through a few questions. I believe in questions with young people I work with as well. The only thing I can do with them and for them is to help them to ask better questions, to formulate it better, because then you're on your way to a good answer. But if you make up your mind before the question, and you find many people like that, they have no questions, many talented people, because from three they teach you, you're the clever oak in the class, you better have answers. We don't give marks for questions. And then 15 years later, you feel embarrassed to have a question, because they told you for 15 years, you get marks for answers. And I hope you guys as well don't fear questions, because they lead you to good places. Those are the questions I quickly want to run with, and I know we're limited on time, so I'll move on. Just as we talk about this, ask yourself a few questions as well, please. Don't only talk about South Africa, because you're a little South Africa as well. This place is just an empty piece of land, plus 54 million people. We are South Africa. So check yourself as well. If you were a nation, how wealthy and healthy and well would you have been? If you check yourself and your family as you check South Africa. Many people don't go there, because it's easier out there, you know. First one, what's our most important asset base? If you have to, from tomorrow, around the braai, tell people about South Africa. I would remind them how proud they should be that they still, over the last 21 years, the only new democracy that's working on planet Earth. In fact, in modern history, they're still the prime example of a democracy. Not outcome, guys. Remember, there is never an outcome in a democracy. It's a process, a never-ending day-to-day process. Every day starts over again, and every day will have their issues. That's a democracy. But you sort it out in a different way. That's the difference about a democracy. The best example for me about a democracy, you know, and I promise you, when President Mandela started the intent of this democracy, intent is very important. Egypt's intent at their start now, not pure enough. Libya, unfortunately, and I think Syria is there as well, and quite a few other oaks in the Middle East as well. The original intent is not pure enough. They're really not too interested in a real democracy. We were. Thank goodness for that man and the shoulders he stood on at that point in time, because the intent was pure enough that we can formulate this real democracy. Now, a democracy in my mind is a traffic light. That's the closest I can get to understanding a democracy. A traffic light is a wonderful thing. I mean, you stop when he talks to you, but there's no person. And you sit and wait for it. This dead thing in front of you, you wait for it. And you're the only car there. Hopefully you wait. But there you sit, waiting for a light to go green. And all people do it. And the democracy is regulating those six lanes, because they all want to go. They want green. And guys, even democracies get it wrong from time to time. I mean, what happened in 2008 in America, the financial one, they had business. They broadened that lane. And they said, come, we like you more. You drive, you get a longer green. And what did you find, you know, in 2007? A big bust up. And then the democracy will have to come back and say, you know, let's narrow the lane again, let's become fair again. Let's put back the traffic light. So the wonderful thing about the traffic light, it's neutral. That's all. You trust it. No one is fiddling with it. That's why it's working so well. And South Africa has a very functional traffic light. You know, when you put a speed cop in there, some of them may well like red cars and say, okay, red car. Because humans are humans, you know, they tend to have a bias, while a traffic light has no bias. Then you have a real democracy. And what you see in the Middle East happening now is all bias. They want to stand in the middle and regulate. Then you still don't have one. What we have in the middle is a book. That's our traffic light. It's called a real mother of a constitution. It's the best on earth still at this point in time, you know, best modern constitution on earth. Not one change, 17 small changes, everyone signed off on it, but like street name changes. But the constitution 21 years later is as set as it was on day one, and there's no even word about changing it. Guys, it's a miracle. For those of you who come from that field as well, you'll remember after the Second World War, Germany's constitution was changed 45 times in 5 years. That's how impure it was, hateful it was. Hats off for the guys who wrote that. They did a very good job. Now, when you look at what's happening around that constitution, every day this constitutional process is tested in a court. And every day someone is getting a chance to lose. And everyone is equal. Then you have a real traffic light working. And it's happening in South Africa. The second important thing, I think that's a misunderstanding in South Africa, people tend to think because we have a big party in charge, we don't have democracy. It's an absolute misnomer. There is so much democracy taking place in that party, you won't believe it. It's just not sort of split in the press. That's all. Those of you who have connections there, you'll know. There's a lot of stuff going on in that party, but it's internal. Don't think you have to have two stalemate parties to have a real democracy. You need a book to have a democracy. And then after that, you know, the rest is a bit of noise. For the first time now with Julius and his men, we have actually an opposition party that on a new ticket is upsetting government. Unfortunately, I think it won't last because they're too unstructured. Because politics is a game of precision. You better get your ducks in a row and you better get financial backing for your plan. And over the last 20 years, any party you didn't get that right. Just fizzled out eventually as well. So Cope was there and a few others as well. And my best guess is that a few years from now that will happen there as well. And you'll probably remain with 1 or 2% vote. Except if they get their ducks in a row and they become structured. But just upsetting Parliament from time to time, you know, and stopping proceedings, I don't think that's good enough. It's entertainment value for a while, but after that you better have a case. And you better have backing then. Otherwise, it will just go away. I like the public protector. You know, I would have worried if the ANC liked her. Because that's exactly why she's there. For them not to like her. Doing a fantastic job. Then guys, I think our voting machine, I hope you guys realize that we have the best on earth at this point in time. It takes America the best part of a week to count their votes. It takes us about 24 hours. And I work with the company Affrages, who is doing the technology behind that process. Absolutely mind-blowing in terms of how sophisticated we are on running elections. The ISC is one of those just public vehicles in South Africa we can be so proud of. And then there's no suppression of talented people in South Africa. This whole story of we're the next Egypt and we're the next Syria and we're the next this and that. You guys realize it cannot be at this point. For one simple reason. No one is intentionally suppressed in South Africa. There's disparity, but not by choice. It's by history. And as long as you have that, you don't have young Nelson Mandelas being suppressed and told, no, because you come from there, or you're from that religion, or you're a woman, or this or that, you cannot. It doesn't exist in South Africa. And therefore, you'll have these small little outlet valves, always happening in a democracy. But this Egypt thing, you know, I'm afraid I don't see that happening. Now, South Africa is number 44 in the world, out of a good 150 countries. So we're one of the top sort of third democracies on planet Earth. I would be proud of it. And remember, you have to protect it. Democracy goes away if you don't protect it. At local level, you know, national level, household level, wherever you have it. It's a protect thing you have to protect and work. If you need a strong president to solve a country, you have a problem. Because you're going to get one. Then you have problems. And South Africa had a wonderful innings now of three levels, types of presidents. Peacemaker, Mr. Mandela, a very clever man, Mr. Mbeki, a grassroots president, President Zuma. And South Africa stayed bigger than all three. So we saw all three of them through, and there will be a new one again. So we had different sort of character presidents in South Africa over the last 20 years. And South Africa just kept on going. It's a very good test to pass. And we actually fired a president in South Africa as well, from the inside, talking about no democracy when you have a strong party. We fired one without any social turmoil. And 6 months later, we had a new president. That is fairly new for a developing country, I promise you. And you were part of that. Guys, and just a small list. That's all I want to say about democracy. It sounds like a very small subject, but if the answer was there, no, everything else we talked about now is a waste of time. That's the foothold. If we get this right, there's hope for anything in South Africa. Be immensely proud of the type of political system you have. Guys, and it's working. I know the voice out there is for a strong man. Give us a strong president. Give us a leader. You should hope for the opposite. Give us a democracy that's working. If you need a hero, you will get one. You'll get a Napoleon, and they will lead you to places. Okay. South Africa, as I said, you know, is the modern example of how democracy can establish itself. Second important thing, guys, very important macroeconomic policy in South Africa. We have an amazing economic policy. And what I want to make you aware of here is that economics is actually very important. We all want 5% economic growth and 10% economic growth. Guys, you won't get it. I promise you. There's no airy-fairy world out there where you turn a switch and you have 5% economic growth. In a real place, it's a hell of a story to get to that level. Now, I just want to remind you, when you compare South Africa's debt level, so I want to put my finger just on two things on economic policy, because that's the ultimate test. How do you feel about debt? And there's South Africa. In other words, we're one of the most solvent nations on planet Earth. That's government debt as a percent of GDP. And you compare it, there's Mr. Greece downstairs there, you can see Greece there, and Japan downstairs there, wonderfully efficient country, technically bankrupt. UK, the US, if they were businesses, they were up for takeovers. If they were businesses. If you're a guy in the United States today, you're born with $1.2 million of debt. That's your birth present. You'll probably roll it over to your kid again with interest, because that's how it works. But that's how all empires come to an end. They just roll debt. South Africa is extremely sensitive about this issue called debt. Guys, and then the second important one, you can see where we are in terms of government debt as well. And you can see in our latest budget as well, we plan to keep it there. So, I mean, that you won't find in the news. It's way too boring. You see, but you have to feel for real numbers and facts and statistics, because guessing in the air and talking about South Africa out there, there's South Africa. And debt is the end of many good games. All empires on this planet up to now came to their end because of one word, overextension, debt. So that's one about economic policy and the latest budget. We're busy farming down our deficit now. After 2008, you know, the deficit increased, but government spending is being, there's a cap on government spending now. I hope you guys, as young people as well, don't like debt. Don't like debt. I come from a financial world, and the horror stories I saw in that world, however smart those people were, if they become fancy with this debt thing, they call it gearing and, you know, leverage and bridging, all types of cool words. Call it debt. And don't have it. And pay it back. It's a wonderful idea. You turn the odds tremendously in your side when you do that. For a nation as well. South Africa is number 2 in the world in terms of transparency on government debt. Which is remarkable. In the world, not the third world, the world. So if you want to know what's happening in government's books, you may know if you want to know. If you want to know, because it's a democracy, remember. And then just one little picture I want to show you. Look at this. Do you see the red is interest rates in South Africa? And the blue is the inflation. Now this is the United States. Sometimes interest rates are above inflation, then it's below inflation. Then it's above inflation, then it's below. Well, it costed them, huh? 2008, that's the reason for that. That's the reason for that. Look at all those, you line yourself up for a crash in the future, because the moment interest rates increase now, you have it. South Africa's picture, let me just show you South Africa's picture. And I mean, the first world guys, what's happening in Europe now, it's all this. They fiddle with money. They make interest rates 0%. In other words, they say, take it, man. It's free. Just take it. You're actually stupid not to take it. But man, when it increases, it catches you out. South Africa's picture, look at our consistent line. We never make credit cheap. And that's the only thing I want to show you. In this building, you know, Geert de Wet, the professor I had in economics, he always told us, you know, that's the first thing you look for is real interest rates. In other words, above inflation. If they start fiddling with that and say, make it cheaper than other price increases, there's a thing waiting for you around the corner. We don't play that game in South Africa. Now, I know many businesses don't like government because of this. Because they would love people to buy with cheap money. And therefore they hammer government for doing this. But luckily, they stick to their guns. We're immensely internationally connected as well. We're the only country on earth I know of who's in love with the East and the West, and they all love us back. No, they don't blame us for it, you know. You go to China and America says, no, go, it's okay if you go. And then we go to the US and China says, no, it's cool, you go. Don't underestimate Mr. Zuma's international capacity. People underestimate this. When I talk to the business people, you guys do as well, always traveling with him. He always takes at least 90 business people with him on his travels, 90. And open doors for them, wherever they are. But people will not write one sentence about it. Don't know why. It's maybe just too good. That's all I want to say about economics. Just screen through those few things. If that's in place, more or less, your economy is going. And from a policy point of view, I can really not tell the government anything about improve that or improve that, except semantics, you know, a few small things. So guys, we have a very solvent. When Mrs. Clinton was here some 6-9 months ago, she said, you know, they're actually learning from our Reserve Bank how to run monetary policy. I was astounded when I heard that. It's amazing, third world country. Then we have a big match temperament. We have this thing about fixing big things. I hope you're proud of that as well. I mean, when Madiba died, we flew in 62 world leaders. 62 in a week. And out again. Without any incident. After the previous Pope, the biggest funeral on earth. Within a week, in and out. Including the biggest man himself. So we're very good at big things. Unfortunately, with smaller things, we're not that good. And I promise you, it's only in South Africa where that man can walk past the CIA and give his speech, his peculiar speech. It's only in South Africa. So don't give us too small a challenge, you know. We're not very big at it. But give us a big thing, we rock up. Now, just talking about a big thing, Eskom. 2 years from now, electricity will be solved in South Africa. Promise you, two years from now. But not in the classical way, you know, government became hyper-efficient and this and that. Because of you guys, you know, in business and in this building, spreading your wings and inviting all types of other power sources and plugging it into the system. We're free to do it and we will. And they'll carry on, but one day Eskom will be the generator, I promise you, because of all the other initiatives that's unfolding as we speak here. Amazing things unfolding at this point in time. Guys, we have an amazing infrastructure. May I just quickly play you this? If you talk about potholes, just want to show you a real pothole. This is just off the N1. That's a pothole, but that's a Chinese pothole. So the China we admire so much, you know, that's their size of potholes. They're big on everything. What you have in South Africa, I mean, when you talk to people visiting us from the first world, they're absolutely blown away by the infrastructure in South Africa. So please don't become one of those people always harping on the potholes you get. Look around you guys, just look around you. You sit in a first world infrastructure. We have issues, but don't miss this because of the issues. Every airport in this country, you can be so proud of it. You will not find those airports in the world out there. It's yours, man. You've created it. You were part of that. A Nigerian visitor the other day told me, you guys aren't from Africa, you're out of Africa. And it was so cool, you know, to listen to a Nigerian smiling, actually saying, you guys don't know what you're talking about when you talk about Africa. And he made actually a very good point, you know. We are the Europe of Africa. We're the Europe of Africa. And then I'm so proud of you guys sitting here. You are our first new generation who are not contaminated. Man, I love you. Because when I was here, it was different. We were so broken up and segmented. And for the first time now, we have a new generation in South Africa. I walked through for 10 minutes through this campus today again. I'm just getting goosebumps to see what I see, how beautiful it is to see a young, bright, energetic new generation. If we can buy two more of you, in other words, your generation, South Africa is home and dry. Two more. Because we will have to invest in three generations. Your kids will be the next generation. We'll have to lift to a new level and then another generation. Because we messed up for very long in South Africa. You don't turn that around in 20 years. So everyone out there saying you had 20 years to fix this, you don't fix things in 20 years, you broke for 300 years. It's a bit more difficult than that. And we got 120 back now. Please guys, take it on. Take it on. Make this work. It's a beautiful, beautiful generation I see in South Africa. Unfortunately, you know, the press are writing about the downside of that. People not good enough at maths and so on. Of course it is out there. But they never write about you. They never write about you. I have not seen a front page article about this beautiful place. That's not, you know, if it's a negative one. I wish they would walk around here and take pictures and say, there they are, guys, that's your future. They don't do it. So please don't become, you know, sort of blindsided by the typical view as well. As I have to rush, the top four challenges now in South Africa, if I have to list them, the first one, if we can get to 4% percent economic growth, not 10, 4, we sit at 2 now, it will make a huge difference. A huge difference. There's our history of economic growth. 60s, 70s, can you see the dark holes in the 70s and 80s there? And then after 94, we picked up very well again, but now we're sitting more or less there now. 1.8, 2%, just over 2% economic growth. What we need is, remember now population growth in the 60s was there. So as a rule of thumb, you know, if your economic growth is higher than your population growth, it's all cool. But then the 70s and 80s, economic growth fell way below population growth, and that's where poverty started, true poverty in South Africa. That's where informal settlements started in South Africa. We never had informal settlements in the 50s. They started in the 70s because of poverty distribution. Luckily, after 94, that happened again. So we had the 60s over again after 94. And then 07 came, a world collapse. Not our doing, guys. I mean, many people just don't know that anymore, some 7 years later. They still think it's our fault. We're a big exporter. We can't help it, you know, if the world goes bust. So what we want is that type of economic growth. Just doubling what we have now. Forget about higher. Our population growth now, depending on how you measure it, is somewhere between 0 and 1.5. That's more or less where it is. Which means it's just about standing still now. We're one of 9 countries in the world that will peak at some point now in the next few years at roughly 58 million people, they say. And then we'll get more or less at that level, which is not actually very good for the future. You need new blood in the system. But that's a different challenge. The big thing that will pull us out of this from 2 to 4 is Europe. That's all. We can talk about Eskom and this and that and wider roads, but that's semantics, guys. We need a growing Europe because we export to Europe. That's all. That will make the difference between 2 and 4. So hopefully Europe is getting its act together now. I think it is. With the exception of Greece, Europe made big changes over the last 7 years, and it will pay off one of these days. But to compare us to Africa and say we should grow by 5 because Ghana is growing by 5%, there's no argument in that. Many countries in Africa are building tar roads for the first time. That's economic growth. Put in electricity for the first time, and pipes, you know, sure it's pipes. South Africa has it. So we don't have base, root-based growth anymore in South Africa. Our growth is a different type of story, you know. We don't build bridges, we have bridges. And that's where people get this wrong, you know. They compare us to Africa's growth rate, but there's no correlation between those two worlds. We're the Europe of Africa. We have that stuff, you know, they're busy growing on. And then the second challenge, I think, there is to just make sure that we big time invest in human backlogs in South Africa. Guys, and there's a simple number. Two-thirds of South Africans, you guys sitting here, part of that two-thirds, we really don't have big issues. You know, we have normal issues. But a third of South Africans have serious issues. You guys know them. They're out there somewhere, typically in rural areas. Not always, but typically in rural areas. They have a hard time surviving. So there's a third thing about South Africa. A third of our population is really in dire straits. When you look through this little set of wellness principles, I think when you look at health, and remember guys, I mean, you can have wonderful dreams, but if your health is not in place, there's nothing in place. So please, for you as youngsters as well, I preach so often to 30-year-olds, look after your health. It's your frame, it's your platform. You will have to look after your body. It's how simple it is. Please own up to it. What you see in South Africa is there's a huge backlog still in that third of the population. For the rest of us guys, we can hang in there, we can cope. But for that third, really issues, big issues. Big thing happened under President Zuma. We turned life expectancy around. Apparently, there's no other good example except wartime examples where this rapid turnaround in life expectancy happened. Except simply because of antiretrovirals. It's as simple as that. And luckily, it's making a mark now. There's nothing good about sickness. So I hope that the nation will heal totally one of these days. You know, it's a tough battle, because out there people just don't know what we're talking about now. They're not informed. Economics, very simple one there. I think, you know, there's a big thing about, you know, if we grow by 7%, then all people will work. It's really not that simple. If you grow by 7% in this varsity, you won't walk out there and employ people, just first guys you get, because now there's growth. It's a different story. Employability and growth, not the same thing. We have an employability issue in South Africa. Not an employment issue, employability issue. And it's a big one as well, you know, it's a fundamental one. A good quarter of the population, the working population there, is unemployable, whatever the economic growth rate. So for people saying, you know, we have 16 million people in the social net already, you know, with the grant system, and therefore it's bad, they don't know what they're talking about. If we haven't had that, we had serious issues. Because that's the people you talk about. And remember, it's not lazy people, it's not young people, it's babies, it's older people, it's disabled people getting those grants. Those are the three parties getting grants. So I don't know how people get to the answer that therefore lazy people will stay lazy. They can't get grants. And 16 million of South Africa's population, the grant number is still about 2.7% of GDP. International benchmark is 3%. Then and we're farming it down to 2.5% now. So our grant contribution to the nation is 2.5% of GDP, which is well below 3%. I'm just making that point for you guys to use over a braai as well. We have a big unemployment problem, and the unemployment issue is in the lower level of age. It's amazing. After 26, it's rapidly declining unemployment in South Africa. But in the first bit, for you guys as youngsters going out there one of these days, go and do your thing. You know, don't worry too much to get this hell of an important job on day one. Go and chip away at it. I promise you, you know, the moment you start becoming fit at work, there will be flow happening in your life. So don't be despondent as you sit here and say there's no jobs because what newspapers say and so on. You are the job. You are it. Don't wait for someone to offer you a job. Be the job man. You know, create your own future. There's a big talk about gaps. The gap between wealthy and poor. That's more or less the layout of South Africa's wealth pyramid. So there's a big bottom and a small top. I just don't think why this is an important argument. As an economist, it baffles me that people can have so many arguments about the gap. Because if you tomorrow tell Bill Gates, Bill, give back all your money, how will it improve America? You know what I'm saying? What? You know, everyone will have more or less two Big Macs and that's it. And then the wealth is gone. So this whole thing that we should shrink the gap, and therefore the argument, soft argument is therefore poverty will go away. I don't think it's true. I don't think it's true. So stop that whole argument, or stop people having that argument. What we need to do is to unpoor the poor. Leave the oaks at the top, they sort out themselves. Let them pay their taxes and so on, not be crooks. Those, all those good things, you know. But don't try to get their wealth lower and therefore the bottom will be higher. That's not true. If your car is smaller, someone else's isn't bigger. It's a funny argument. So our whole economic argument should be how to unpoor the poor. That should be the argument. That should be the argument. In other words, we need to transform South Africa's economy to that form. And the chipping away part are the pink part at the bottom there. That's the big part. You always have poor people. And you'll always have wealthy people, wherever you live. So if there's no sort of criminal affairs involved and so on, just accept it. That's life. The middle is important. If you're serious about a democracy, the middle is important. A middle class is always looking after a democracy. We have a pink challenge there, and what we need to do is to chip away at the pink challenge, because guys, that pink block still there, those two. There are so many very poor people out there. They're innocent guys, and you know many of them, they're innocent, but they have hell on earth. Okay. And our duty is to chip away at that. And once you go through a building like this, you guys, you're home and dry, do you realize that? You'll never be in that pink block again after leaving here. Because you're equipped. You're equipped to do your thing. Whatever you do. There's a wonderful increase in the black middle class in South Africa. And that's why the bubble is starting to take form now. This rugby ball type of format of wealth is starting to happen. People don't write about that, but there's an explosion in the middle class. I remember in the early 80s when I was here, driving from here to Pretoria, for instance. I mean, the whole Midrand was a veld. It was open. Only the Development Bank was there and Johnson & Johnson. The rest was a veld. When you drive there now, you struggle to find an open space. Now, what your eyes should see is all the townhouses, because that's middle classness. All those people buy or rent with real moolah. No subsidy, real money. And the buildings you'll see there, all the businesses you'll see there, are real businesses. Not funny money businesses, like in China, you know, you have all these big buildings, but built by the state. All full. It's eye blind. We see there private buildings, built with real money, real businesses. So guys, the middle class is starting to happen. I'm going to take 5 more minutes of your time. Then family. It's a very important thing, family. I hope you agree with me, you know, but to have 3 million orphans in South Africa is really not good enough. It's a after-war number that. Only countries after wars have that type of number of orphans. And they're out there, guys. You know it, they're out there. And the Red Cross told me the other day, you know, and I captured this, the Red Cross Children's Hospital in Cape Town. They say, we're always talking about the violated kids, which is very important, you know, we must prevent that from happening. But what they say is people don't realize, for every one, 10 die running over a highway, falling off a roof, burning with paraffin. I mean, that hospital is full of people who burned, babies who burned, because of lack of family. That's how they end up there. Lack of supervision. So for you guys moving into that space, I hope if there's one of two priorities, I hope one of those two is to be good dads. This country needs dads. Okay. There are way too many lonely mums out there. It's hell to raise a human being. It needs two people. Be different. Dare to be different. Okay. 39% of South African men still don't live at home. And it's coming a long way, guys. This is a 100-year story now. Old track arbeid, taking dads away from home. So that's the tail end of this whole story still. So the culture is just now, well, it's normal to live away from home. It's not normal. It's not good for that oak you choose to bring into this world. It's not good enough. Only 30% of kids in South Africa have to have two parents. You see? So if we talk about economics here, economics is starting in a family, around a dinner table. The varsity will come later, dinner table. And there need to be two kind voices around that dinner table. It is such a front foot it's giving you in life. Hard part, you know, moral part, we're coming a long way in South Africa. It went very wrong in South Africa on that intelligence part, you know, and Bishop Tutu said a very important thing. We're still all wounded in South Africa. And you don't just wish it away after 20 years, guys. This nation is still carrying deep wounds because of its past. And our job sitting in this room tonight is to help heal those wounds, wherever we find them, whoever it is having that wound as well, and recognize your own as well. I think it's very important. So I don't think it's as easy as saying, well, get over it, you know, it's so many years later. It's not that simple. Intellectual development, and that's where you sit in your game, and that's a point on its own there. I think if we can just make education a big, big priority in South Africa. I don't exactly know how, because you guys work in that domain. But that's what we need in South Africa. But just the problem I stand in front when I think about this is it starts at home. It starts at home. This is an outsourced partner for a family, this building, you know. It's not standing in for a family. So can you see where this thing, you know, it's pointing back to homes. Your gift to South Africa is to create loving, constructive homes. That's what we need in South Africa. When you look at schools in South Africa, if I have to break it up, about 10% is really world-class schools. I mean, we're the only country on earth now with listed schools on the JSE. That's how private it went. I mean, it's phenomenal to see that happen. How free South Africa is to do what you want to. You can educate if you want to. It's a democracy. Okay schools, 30%. I mean, there are many Model C schools in South Africa, still world-class, for public schools, world-class. But then, unfortunately, a good 50 to 60% of our kiddies go to terrible places every day. You cannot actually even call it a school. They even say it's dangerous there for those kids to go there. But they pitch, huh? They pitch, they want to learn. Now, again, you know, we're not getting a good ranking in terms of human capital development in South Africa. And that's where we have to crack this one. We can't wish the economy up, but the human capital is staying behind. It's the other way around. Human capital is creating an economy. So for you guys as educators, I hope you realize you're on holy ground every day. You can make a difference like in no other country by just understanding this dilemma we have in South Africa. I talked to a bank a week ago, you know, they're busy organizing places for some of their workers to sleep during a day. Because, I mean, the aha moment was to realize that some of those workers have to get up 2:30 in the morning to arrive in time at a building in Sandton. They're dead tired by 10 o'clock in the morning. Now imagine you don't have understanding for that type of issue. What the stereotyping is, you can get lost in. Education guys, only 17% people of a younger age is holding skilled jobs. So there's a big below skilled market out there, and you know where that comes from. Luckily you can see huge increases in enrollment of youngsters, which is a wonderful breakthrough. It's much better there. And people underpopulate this, but this is so important. Unfortunately still, this is very small print, but when you look through that article, they say grade R people in poor areas still don't pick up real skill for grade one. In affluent areas, there's a tremendous increase in skill because of grade R, because of parents helping. So you can see, even at that level, a school cannot catch what parents should catch. So guys, that's one of the biggest solutions in South Africa, is that level, you know, it's a parent thing in South Africa. Luckily, we are so robust as a nation. You guys sit here, and for many of you listening to this now, I mean, the penny must be very close to home that's dropping for you, because you probably come from a place like that. But good for you. You saw it through. You're tough enough and you're robust enough to sit here today. Just continue with that energy. It will take you places, I promise you. And you see these beautiful things starting to happen of people coming from areas like that. And this is where I'm going to just stop tonight too, because our time is up, man. I could not do a long story, but our time is up. What we need to do here is to make sure that we eliminate management voids in the public service. It's a management issue happening out there. It's not an intent issue. No one wants to live in a bad South Africa. One of the biggest oversights we have in 1994, if I have to list five, one of the biggest ones was to underestimate the skill of management. My dad always told me when the Nationalist Party took over in 1948, they made exactly the same mistake. They chased out all the English-speaking Oaks and they put Afrikaners in. And they weren't trained for the jobs. And it took them a best part of 20 years to understand it. To realize, oops, you know, these Oaks, you know, they have the job now. But there's much more than a position going on here. Management is a skill. And you transfer it through generations. So we should have mentored much longer after 94. And help people not to fail. Because otherwise you set them up for failure. SAA, you know, ESCOM, wherever you look, you set them up for failure. Because it's an experience thing. The biggest failure we have in South Africa is this local, in rural areas at local government level. If a ferry can fly over South Africa now and fix a few of those municipalities, we'll go a long way. Many of our departments are actually doing remarkably well, guys. I sat in America in a workshop a while ago, and they had to list their good state departments. You know, they couldn't find one. Say, well, they're corrupt, queues are long. And I looked at my partner, I told him, where do we sit now, in South Africa or in America? Because they talk like South Africans about this. And I told him, I have two for you. They said, yes. I said, SARS and the IEC. And I can throw in tourism there for you guys as well. And they said, what is SARS? You know, they thought it's the virus. But that the point is, you know, we actually have more functional, according to them, more functional government departments than they appreciate. It's not a problem of money. It's a problem of commitment and training. That's what it is. And it took us 20 years for that to come through. So luckily, I think the message is out there now. Please just don't think this is a lost cause. I think this was a masterstroke from the president to put Mr. Gordon in that position to look at local governments. Watch local governments over the next 5 years. You're going to see remarkable differences taking place there. This Oak is not for sissies. He's going to make a few... He's going to make a few differences, this Oak. And I already hear the rumors coming from municipalities. They walk faster, I promise you. At his first conference with him on a Sunday about 6 months ago, that was his first message. From now on, we're all going to walk faster. Isn't that interesting, eh? We're going to walk faster. Managership is a skill, guys. It's a big thing. Please don't underestimate what we did achieve over the last 20 years. We really underestimate what happened here. I mean, we had remarkable breakthroughs in terms of achievement. And to increase electricity from 34% to 87% of the nation. I mean, guys, for us who grew up with lights, to suddenly have electricity, It's heaven. And it's happening out there. 78% people are living in real places now. 78%. Now it's only 20% still to chip away in terms of putting them in structures that's reliable. And the municipal IQ, a private watchdog, is saying that actually most municipalities are very functional. That's a private watchdog. The world is saying South Africa's got the 34th most efficient government. That's according to their rating, not a South African rating. So they rate South Africa's government much higher than its own people because they compare a good 190 governments. Now, President Truman in America said an interesting thing. He said, beware of a very efficient government because they turn into dictators, Roman Empire-like. We're so efficient, you know, just give all of it for us. We'll do it for you. And then a good 100 years later, you're called Greece, where 50% of the population is working for the civil service. Right, now a few questions and then I'll pop to the other things because there's a few other good things I want to share with you and hopefully it's a question.
The University of Johannesburg. Rethink. Reinvent.